Throughout our hearings, you've heard how President Trump made baseless claims that voting machines were being manipulated by foreign powers in the 2020 election. You've also heard Trump's Attorney General, Bill Barr, describe such claims as complete nonsense, which he told the president. Let's review that testimony.
I saw absolutely zero basis for the allegations, but they were made in such a sensational way that they obviously were influencing a lot of people, members of the public, that there was this systemic corruption in the system and that their votes didn't count and that these machines controlled by somebody else were actually determining it, which was complete nonsense. And it was being laid out there. And I told them that it was crazy stuff and they were wasting their time on that. And it was doing a great, grave disservice to the country.
We've learned that President Trump's White House counsel agreed with the Department of Justice about this.
Attorney General Barr made a public announcement on December 1st, less than a month after the election, that he had seen no suspended fraud sufficient. Fair to say that by December 1st, you had reached the same conclusion?
It's fair to say that I agree with Attorney General Barr's conclusion on December 1st. Yes, I did, and I supported that conclusion.
However, the strong rejection of the Attorney General and the White House counsel of these claims did not stop the president from trying to press them in public. But that's not all he did. Indeed, as you'll see in this clip, the president asked Attorney General Bill Barr to have the Department of Justice seize voting machines in the states.
My recollection is the president said something like, we could get to the bottom. You know, some people say we could get to the bottom of this if the department seized the machines. It was a typical way of raising a point. And I said, absolutely not. There's no probable cause, and we're not going to seize any machines. And that was that.
Yeah.
But this wasn't the end of the matter. On the evening of December 18th, 2020, Sidney Powell, General Michael Flynn, and others entered the White House for an unplanned meeting with the president, the meeting that would last multiple hours and become hot-blooded and contentious. The executive order behind me on the screen was drafted on December the 16th, just 2 days after the Electoral College vote, by several of the president's outside advisors over a luncheon at the Trump International Hotel. As you can see here, this proposed order directs the Secretary of Defense to seize voting machines, quote, effective immediately, but it goes even further than that. Under the order, President Trump would appoint a special counsel with the power to seize machines and then charge people with crimes with all resources necessary to carry out her duties. The specific plan was to name Sidney Powell as special counsel, the Trump lawyer who had spent the post-election period making outlandish claims about Venezuelan and Chinese interference in the election, among others. Here's what White House counsel Pat Cipollone had to say about Sidney Powell's qualifications to take on such expansive authority.
I don't think Sidney Powell would say that I thought it was a good idea to appoint her special counsel. I was vehemently opposed. I didn't think she should be appointed to anything.
Sidney Powell told the president that these steps were justified because of her evidence of foreign interference in the 2020 election. However, as we've seen, Trump's allies had no such evidence and, of course, no legal authority for the federal government to seize state voting machines. Here's Mr. Cipollone again denouncing Sidney Powell's terrible idea.
There was a real question in my mind and a real concern, you know, particularly after the Attorney General had reached a conclusion that there wasn't sufficient election fraud to change the outcome of the election. When other people kept suggesting that there was, the answer is, what is it? And at some point, you have to put up or shut up. That was my view.
Why was this, on a broader scale, a bad idea for the country?
To have the federal government seize voting machines, that's a terrible idea for the country. That's not how we do things in the United States. There's no legal authority to do that. there is a way to contest elections, you know, that that happens all the time. But the idea that the federal government could come in and seize election machines, you know, that that's I don't understand why we even have to tell you why that's a bad idea for the country. It's a terrible idea.
For all of its absurdity, the December 18th meeting was critically important because President Trump got to watch up close for several hours as his White House counsel and other White House lawyers destroyed the baseless factual claims and ridiculous legal arguments being offered by Sidney Powell, Mike Flynn, and others. President Trump now knew all these claims were nonsense, not just from his able White House lawyers, but also from his own Department of Justice officials, and indeed his own campaign officials. As White House counsel Pat Cipollone told us,
with respect to the whole election fraud issue, it, to me, it's sort of, if you're gonna make those kind of claims, and people were open to them early on because people were making all sorts of claims, and the real question is, show the evidence, okay?
It wasn't just the Justice Department, the Trump campaign, and the Trump White House lawyers who knew it. Even Rudy Giuliani's own legal team admitted that they did not have any real evidence of fraud sufficient to change the election result. Here's an email from Rudy Giuliani's lead investigator, Bernie Kerik, on December 28, 2020, to Chief of Staff Mark Meadows. Mr. Kerik did not mince any words. We can do all the investigations we want later, but if the president plans on winning, it's the legislators that have to be moved, and this will do just that. Mr. Kerik wanted the president to win. What he didn't say in this email was what he would later tell the Select Committee in a letter that his lawyer wrote to us in November. The letter said, quote, "It was impossible for Mr. Kerik and his team to determine conclusively whether there was widespread fraud or whether that widespread fraud would have altered the outcome of the election." In other words, even Rudy Giuliani's own legal team knew before January 6th that they hadn't collected enough actual evidence to support any of their stolen election claims. Here's what Trump campaign senior advisor Jason Miller told the committee about some of the so-called evidence of fraud that the campaign had seen from the Giuliani team.
So do you know what the examples of fraud, numbers, names, and supporting evidence was that you sent to Mo Brooks's office? And when I say you, I mean you or the campaign.
There are some very, very general documents as far as, say, for example, here are the handful of dead people in several different states. Here are explanations on a couple of the legal challenges, as far as the saying that the rules were changed in an unconstitutional manner. But it was, to say that it was thin is probably an understatement.
Here's how President Trump's deputy campaign manager described the evidence of fraud that the campaign had seen.
You never came to learn or understand that Mayor Giuliani had had produced evidence of election fraud. Is that fair?
That's fair.
And here's testimony that we received from the Speaker of the Arizona House of Representatives, Rusty Bowers, about an exchange that he had with Rudy Giuliani after the election.
At some point, did one of them make a comment that they didn't have evidence, but they had a lot of theories?
That was Mr. Giuliani.
Chief of Staff Mark Meadows told people that he thought Trump should concede around the time the Electoral College certified the result. But nonetheless, he later worked to try to facilitate President Trump's wishes. Here's what Cassidy Hutchinson told us.
During this period, I perceived his goal with all of this to keep Trump in office. You know, he had very seriously and deeply considered the allegations of voter fraud. But when he began acknowledging that maybe there wasn't enough voter fraud to overturn the election, you know, I witnessed him start to explore potential constitutional loopholes more extensively, which I then connected with John Eastman's theories.
The startling conclusion is this: even an agreed-upon complete lack of evidence could not stop President Trump, Mark Meadows, and their allies from trying to overturn the results of a free and fair election.